electric planes.
I'm going to say two words to you.
Yeah.
Range anxiety.
This is a Pipistrel Alpha Electro. This is the first electric plane ever, as far as I'm aware, to have come down here to my home airport of Moorabbin and to be available, hopefully for people like you, if you've ever thought about getting into flight training, but maybe cost has been a bit of a barrier to entry for you. Now, people talk about things like lower maintenance costs, lower running costs. Obviously, you're not paying for gas because these things don't take gas. There are two batteries in this aircraft that you just plug in and recharge just like you would with a Tesla. But is this the future of aviation? Are we all going to be learning to fly in things like electric planes in the future? I'm going to take this for a flight today with Coram, the owner of the aircraft, because I want to find out if this actually is going to be the plane that someone like you is going to learn to fly in.
One thing I noticed, your startup procedure is literally to close the door and to put the power on.
Pretty much. We do have a couple of things to check, and I did check a few things while you were doing setup. In terms of engine checks, there's very little because everything's reported on the screen. So if there's anything that's outside of our regular parameters, we can instantly see it on there.
Well, you don't need to do run-ups. Of course you don't need to do run-ups. So you're not warming the engine up.
Nothing to warm up.
You've already done all your pre-flight checks previously.
Yep.
Because I'm in the run-up bay for, well, on a good day, I can do it in maybe 5-6 minutes.
Yeah.
But on a cold day, I can be sitting there waiting for it to warm up.
Some aircraft
maybe about
for a while.
8, 9, 10 minutes sometimes. So we're just taxiing towards the holding point, and our battery now is at 95%?
95 and 99, so it will draw from both batteries.
This is the thing I love. You're at the holding point, you've pulled the power back to cut off, and the prop stopped.
So you're stuck at a holding point for a while.
You're not burning any energy.
You're not burning any energy, and it's nice. You don't have exhaust flowing over you, and you're not building heat in the engine. And
was that clear for takeoff, Electro 2091?
Electro 2091, affirmative. Clear for takeoff.
Clear for takeoff, Electro 2091.
Takeoff configuration, one stage of flap. Full power. And climb out of here. All right. Off we go. The performance is amazing in this
thing. That's a quick takeoff roll.
We've got huge wings and the equivalent of 100 horsepower motor. We're very light. We're probably only at about 550 kilos or 540 kilos here with our weight today.
All right, I'm going to say two words to you.
Yeah.
Range anxiety. So this gets mentioned when it comes to electric aircraft.
Yeah.
And what about people who say, well, what happens if you go out flying and you just run out of batteries?
Yeah. Yep. Well, the range anxiety is there, but it's not dissimilar, really, to any aviator will understand range anxiety already with fuel. Because if you're planning a couple-hour mission and you've only got so much fuel on board and weight's really, really critical, so you always keep as little fuel as you really need for your mission, just enough for your required reserves, usually. And so range anxiety has been around in aviation for all time.
Yeah.
It's just a little bit more critical, and that's part of what gets taught in the curriculum with this aircraft is critical energy management.
I think when you're deciding on an aircraft to fly, it's really important to look at some actual raw data. So I've got this from the official Pipistrel website. They say the Alpha Electro can cruise at 98 knots. Now, I think that's probably max cruise speed that it can possibly do. Realistically, when we're flying the Alpha Electro, it feels like you get between 85 and 90 knots. So let's say on a good day, you can do 90 knots cruise speed. Max range on their website is stated to be 50 minutes. Now, I believe as well that's probably at a low power setting. If you're going to be high power, doing a lot of climbs, maybe doing some air work, you're not going to get 50 minutes on top of the reserves. And we'll talk about reserves in a second. I'd probably say something like 40 minutes flying time is a bit more realistic. So for 40 minutes flying time at a 90 knots cruise speed, that means on one charge you can cover about 60 nautical miles range. And that becomes important when you look at some of the general aviation airports, especially here in Australia, and you look at the training areas associated with those airports, and you start to look at the distances between the two.
So you just need to be more planned about the exercises, the missions you're going to achieve in the aircraft for the training session.
Yep.
But then also the pilot from a very early stage is learning about there's a finite amount of time that any aircraft has.
Of course, 100%.
It's just the time which is the variable.
And a little bit of extra planning and communication, like we just did with the tower a moment ago. We're maybe planning an odd approach so that we can come in a little bit more direct. So you plan it, ask it, call ahead, and have a nice energy efficient route to come back in on.
Let's have a look at some of the popular airports here in Australia where people generally do flight training. So this is Moorabbin Airport where we are now, and this area here, this is the training area. And the distance between the two is basically, say to the middle of the training area, 17 nautical miles. That means there and back is 34 nautical miles, meaning it gives you about 25, 26 nautical miles of flying in the training area. But that's of course based on no headwinds, no delays getting in and out of Moorabbin. This is Sydney, this is Bankstown Airport, another popular training airport. This is the training area and the distance to that. It's about the same, it's about 17 miles. Up near Brisbane, you've got Archerfield. Now this one's slightly different because the training area is actually here, 11, 12 miles. So it's only about a 20, 25 mile round trip to and from the airport. So theoretically, yes, you could fly this aircraft from a training airport to a training area, especially here in Australia, do a bit of practice flight training and then get back to the airport without any issues. But if there's one thing that I've learned from my flying, it's that you don't plan for the 95% of times when things go well, you plan for the 5%. These are training airports after all, so you plan for the fact that the towers sometimes get so busy they don't let you into their airspace, and that's happened to me on many occasions in the past. You plan for the times when there could be an aircraft that's disabled on the runway, which actually closes the airport, and again, that's happened to me in the past. You even plan for the times when the weather just doesn't do what it's forecast and those headwinds are a lot stronger than you thought, and it takes you maybe another 5 or 10 minutes extra time to get home from the training area. And those are the times when words like contingency and reserves become really important.
How much juice do you have before you land at the airport?
Yeah, great question. There's we need to keep 30% reserve on our indicated battery capacity. That's extrapolated from the way the framework of regulations is already. We don't actually fit particularly in some of the written framework now, but we keep in line with the performance of a Rotax engine aircraft and the reserve requirements they require to operate safely. And that gives us plenty of time and options for holding patterns and an emergency go around if required. So the emergency reserve that we're landing with, which is 30% of the onboard energy, is plenty to safely integrate to a busy circuit pattern, even when we do sometimes get forced into a holding pattern.
People always ask me, why can't you put solar panels on the wing?
Well, technically you could. However, there'd be a weight penalty. And again, we're always weight critical with aviation. There'd also be a cost penalty. It'd add cost to the aircraft. And realistically, the amount of energy it reclaims is not making a viable contribution to the energy we're consuming. We just don't have the surface area on the aircraft to make a meaningful contribution, plus the weight and cost penalty.
Very glamorous charger out the window situation.
So what's that connected to at the other end?
That is that whopping grey box is the AC to DC converter, and it's connected to a 3-phase power outlet.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
And then you just plug that in here.
Yep.
And how long for a full charge?
About 90 minutes. Yeah, that's from 30% to 95%, but we're at only 50%, so it'd be less than an hour.
So the perfect use case of electric aviation now, and probably ongoing in the future, one of its key niches will be in ab initio pilot training. Even PPL and CPL consolidation is still an excellent tool. The modest range of an electric aircraft means they're not a great long transit device. It's not a transport device. But for recreational aviating and pilot training, absolutely stunning. You get that up to 1 hour flight time, which is a typical lesson anyway. And that's typical of a lot of flight schools. They're usually doing 0.7, 0.8s is pretty normal for training flights. All of those flights can be done electric, so it massively reduces costs for operators.
So we've been buzzing around in the air for like about 10 minutes now. We're on the ground for a bit as well. We were kind of doing all the filming and everything, but we're still on 75% battery endurance left.
Now that we're up at this nice height, we're just cruising around doing some mellow turns and enjoying the space. We're not fighting much wind up here at the moment either.
Yeah.
We're able to come back to a really modest power setting of about 16, 17 kilowatts to maintain strength of a flight. But the display is telling us we could fly for another 42 minutes at this power level. There's only a handful of electric aircraft in the whole country.
Yeah.
And there's only really a handful in the world. There's less than 300 active electric aircraft on Earth. So this is an extremely unique experience, and not your first in the electric aircraft.
It's my second time in an electric aircraft, but it's my first time at my home airport. And it's really quiet. It's really nice up here.
It's a beautiful experience.
Smooth.
So smooth.
It is very smooth.
Yeah. Because it's such a nice slippery low drag airframe, it feels good through the air. It's not disrupting a lot of air. It's very smooth and it's got a really nice directional feel. Now we're just going to do a little bit of a turn here.
Yeah.
Slightly steep. And head back on down to for our.
You want to take us back in?
Electro 2091, clear to land.
Clear to land, Electro 2091.
All stations, getting a little bit of cross on at the moment, up to 10 knots from the left.
Yep,
a little bit.
Bobby Tower, Oscar X-ray, Julia Samno, ready runway 35 left, after departure to Albert Park Lake.
Nice. So we've come down well above minimum.
I love the world of technology, and that world is the reason why I'm lucky enough to be able to fly a fantastic aircraft like this one behind me. I built a career and a business out of the world of tech. So when the innovation of technology combines with the world of aviation to produce something like an electric aircraft, I get really excited for the future of aviation. But you, as a future pilot or an existing pilot, you are going to have to decide if this is a viable aircraft for you to achieve your aviation objectives, or whether it's just a really good prototype for what we might see in the future of aviation. When you are looking at aircraft, I think it's really important to understand the technical specifications behind that aircraft as well, which is why I think you'll really like this video, taking a bit more of a detailed dive into things like the batteries and the power plant that actually makes this electric aircraft work.